welcome everybody. I'll just start off with a few announcements. So on the 25th of July, Thursday, 3 p.m., we have a seminar by, just tomorrow, we have a seminar by Dr. K.V. Sibyl, who's a junior fellow at the Nehru Memorial. And he'll be presenting a paper on the problematic of Indian untouchability, theories of caste system, and the theory of imitation. And then on the same day, later in the evening at 5:30 p.m., we will have a public lecture as a part of the Science, Society, and Nature series by Dr. Kuntala Lahiri Dutt from the Australian National University. And the title of her paper will be Dancing with the River, Hybrid Landscapes and Livelihoods of Chars in Bengal. On the 26th of July, which is the next day, on Friday at 3 p.m., we'll have a seminar by Dr. Ramnarayan Rawat from the University of Delaware. The title of his paper will be Parallel Publics Towards the Dalit History of Democracy. I'd like to introduce our speaker today, who's Dr. Sindhu Radhakrishna, and she's from the National Institute of Advanced Studies, NIAS, Bangalore. And I just sort of give you a brief introduction. I think her work is very interesting. And so Dr. Radhakrishna is an associate professor at the National Institute of Advanced Studies, and she has a PhD in animal behavior from Mysore University. And her research interests span the areas of primatology, conservation biology, animal studies, and environmental education. And lately, her work has focused on gaining a better understanding of relations between humans and wildlife. And she's also the recipient of many research grants and honors, notably the INSA Young Scientist Award in 2004 and the Nehru Fulbright Fellowship in 2013. So without much ado, I'll just ask her to take off. The paper is titled Rethinking Animal-Human Boundaries, Musings of a Primatology.
Thank you, Vinu. Good afternoon, everybody. And first, I'd like to thank Prof. Rangarajan for inviting me to give this talk here. It's a great pleasure to be here. So animals are, of course, an intrinsic part of human life, whether we accept it or not. And something which my talk is going to do is explore how we actually acknowledge their presence. As the subtitle says, and Vinu had mentioned, I'm a primatologist. So my perspective is largely from that field. Which is rather unusual for studies on animals. We generally tend to be from the fields of sociology, anthropology, history, and philosophy. And although primatologists and generally wildlife biologists are great deal interested in animals, they tend to be rather from a biological perspective and conservation. Looking into relationships between humans and animals is still rather understudied. So with that brief introduction, I will get to the talk. There are various sections. These are only strands of thought that I'm trying to explore. And perhaps if I conclude the section, I'll try to put them together and layer them up. So the first section talks about thinking about animals. So how do we really think about animals? And for this, I'd like to begin with my favorite poet, Simbhulka. Simbhulka is a Polish poet. Extraordinary for her interest in animals and her perspectives on human life, animal lives, which is very unusual. Unusual because people rarely reflect in such detail on the lives of animals. And in this particular poem, which is called View from Above, she talks about the death of a beetle. And somewhere in the third stanza, she goes, and so the dead beetle on the path lies unmoved and shining in the sun. One glance at it will do fermentation. Clearly nothing much has happened to it. Important matters are reserved for us, for our lives and our deaths, a death that always claims the right to save. Really metaphors and very small stanza she puts in a multitude of ideas, the death of a wall, and also the fact that although the beetle exists and we do look at it, in our concentration of life, it is very, very minimal. And that in a way encapsulates, I think, how we actually look at animals. We think about them, we appear a great deal in our lives, but do we really consider anything worth our attention? Not much, really. And that, I think, is a great reason for the book. The next slide has a series of images. And I put these images together because they are popular representations in media of how we think about animals. And I put them together to, you know, talk about how there are many, many representations here. But all of them really only talk about one thing, how the human stance, the apex of human existence is what everybody should achieve to. Human values are what we should all really achieve to. And how organisms really should just achieve to become human, you know, whether they're wild, whether they're animals, or anything at all. If they're also, you know, all the animals in it tend to be used as vehicles to address certain human values or beliefs or ideas. As you can see, the first one, King Kong, is a famous picture. They talk about the parody, the animal as savage, it feels uncivilized, and how it aspires for beauty, and that led to its downfall. The third one on the right is a rather well-known Japanese tale about Hachiko, who waits, or the dog who waits eternally for the master, and embodies his values of loyalty, you know, loyalty to humans, the ultimate that every animal should aspire for. And Hachiko was completely enamored and written a great deal about, and filmed also later, and quite an enduring symbol in Japanese. You will see also the other animation, one about the Berenstain Bears, where again animals are used as vehicles to express certain ideas over their children. And of course, Hemingway's tale. And although all these are about animals on the surface, you know, at the center, they're really about human endurance, human power, human strength, human values. And even the mermaid tale talks about how, you know, the mermaid actually aspires to become human, and that's the end of it. Even when the tale is completely about animals, as we've seen in Madagascar, it's completely anthropomorphic, you know. Every value or belief that animals talk about tend to go back to human beings. And that is just a brief look overview of as to how we think about animals. And now to go on to the next section, let's talk about the crux of the problem. The human, the animal divide. Why are the boundaries between us? Are there really boundaries? How the various cultures look at it? Taking images from this show, you we have a variety of relationships that we share with animals. There are some that we certainly don't want even there are pets that we like to throw them out. There are others that we use both for entertainment and for other uses. There are those that are wild that we should be separate from our society. And there are yet others which happen to be somewhere on the border. Or they are neither wild, they are both domestic, they are companions, but you really saw somebody and they live with us. So these are just a few clues of various kinds of relationships that we can have with animals. In practice, so in theory, you know, in studies, how have you really looked at animals academically? Two areas, just a rough one, social sciences and natural sciences. Social sciences generally have tended to ignore. Because social sciences tend to have a Western modern heritage where man is the center of all things and there is a divide between nature and culture. Man represents culture or society and the animal represents nature and therefore there is a very strong relation between the two. And this has dominated social sciences for a long time. Sociology by definition is about human beings for society and why do you animals have a place in them and animals are typically being denied a place. This is for the general place and I think a lot of interesting writers who were examining the problem much further. You think of what's like Lily Shaw, for example, or Atlas Brown, or even Lee, and philosophers who also talk about how it's important to think about animals, the categories of animals, and what makes it to us. But generally, for the time, for a long time, there is no presence of animals in human life. Natural sciences that work, you know, animals are at the center of what they study, what they look at. But interestingly, biology tends to reduce everything down to the objective reduction scale, and because of this, the organism is never an agent, it's always a subject of inquiry, so it was very inquiry, and the emphasis has always been on trying to be very objective, never to cross over into a subject or look at the entire subject. That's the intent in natural sciences. And this was perpetuated for a very, very long time. Over the last few decades, there have been changes in this view of thought. And why did this come about? Because there are studies which show that animals are sentient, they experience pain and pleasure. There have also been studies that show talk about animal consciousness. Again, animal culture there are dangers that get into, but some studies seem to show that, and the effect of this seems cumulatively build up. And over the last 3 decades, animal studies, or studies that focused on animals and human-animal relationships began to gather more power. And sociologists began to talk about this and write about this, and you have Arup and Sanders and many other authors who wrote a great deal about this, Margaret Mullin, anthropologist, who wrote about how anthropology should start looking at animals and make them the subject of the inquiry. But you will notice that the first change of thinking in social sciences was still dominated by the humanist perspective. So when you have Arup writing in 2006 on animals, her study looked at links between cruelty to animals and cruelty in interpersonal relationships. And it's very significant that even when you were writing about animals, the tendency or the crux of the matter was to make humans the center of it. So very anthropocentric, that how do we benefit humans, how is of use to humans if we look at animal relationships, correlations between humans and animals. So that was the first wave of thinking, but animals started becoming subjects of matters of inquiry. The second way of thinking is what sociologists would like, or animal studies would like to club as post-humanism, in the sense that human at the center of the universe began to be very deliberately moved apart, and animals began to be paid more attention. And this very generally called a post-humanist trend, and it began to be reflected in works that came out during that era. You also had another very interesting trend coming in called multi-species ethnography, where anthropologists started looking at very small organisms, which are early on the periphery of human thinking, bacteria, mushrooms, small animals, and these started coming into the foreground, and they began to be very, very interesting work being written about them. We have Raffles writing in 2010 a book on insects, where insects are the center of the entire book, very, very lovely piece. We have Singh writing about mushrooms and how they grow and develop and set up networks, very nice work. So you have this new trend coming where you have anthropologists and scholars from other disciplines writing about these very small organisms on the periphery and showing importantly how they network with human life, whether humans realize it or not, whether they want it or not, how the networks that link humans and these other organisms together. So that was the main thought which changed the world and brought animal studies into that prominence. So with this, what happens is that people start talking about boundaries between animals and humans. You know, when the human being is not anymore at the center of thinking, what happens? Are divides between animal and human really real? Are they porous? How can they be changed? And at this point, there's something else we're seeing. That's a bioscientific hybrid. In the 1990s, we started talking about trans-species transplantation data for the growth or change of tissues, organs between humans and animals. And then this had now come into the embryo. They actually take all the nucleus, put it into the human or the animal nucleus, and try to see if it grows. And debates around this are fascinating to study because they show how very uncomfortable humans are about changing boundaries. There were, of course, a whole series of debates about the moral implications of a half-human, half-animal hybrid. Those that have tried in primary school were not successful, the organisms never developed quickly or correctly enough. But there was a series of transactions over the existence of this embryo that led to very, very interesting debates. For example, there was a group that applied to the American Patent Office for a patent for the half-chimp, half-human hybrid. And the American Patent Office turned it down, citing the 13th Amendment of the American Constitution, which says that human beings cannot be sold into slavery. So at that point, because the human factor was higher in the embryo, that's how they chose to treat it. The other side of the story is that of the UK Xenotransplantation Interim Regulation Authority, which was set up in the 1990s to regulate the whole process or laws relating to the process of this transplantation business. It broke down, by the way, in 2006 because it did not function very well. But during the time that it worked, it was never very clear whether it should be the embryos or the issues related to this. So this should be treated by the Home Affairs Ministry, which means human, or the Health Ministry, which means it's an organism. So we people are never very clear as to how or where we even place this. The other question is, of course, that of morals, you know. So is this human? Is this animal? And what moral standing does this new hybrid creature have, if it ever develops at all? The third was, of course, legal. Where is this exactly placed? Does this have a citizenhood? Does it have a personhood? Are we talking about new trans species? And another aspect is how language was used to mark or to subvert the whole debate and the discomfort over the half she and half chimp hybrid. Initially, these embryos were called trans species embryos, and over a mass of time, it became human ethnic embryos, whereby you could have more control over this human being, human creature, or put in more law to treat this hybrid as more human than more chimpanzee. So yes, so that was another big question which led to the blurring of boundaries between human and hybrid. Human and animal, human and chimpanzee. Do any of these have human standing? Do they have animal standing? How do rules relate to them? And this, of course, adds to the larger debate about animal consciousness and sentience, and what are boundaries between human and animal? Do they blur? Do they remain? I come now to the section where I deal with what is my favorite subject, primates, and what they add to the whole debate. So over the last decade, it's been the decade of the animal, or the animal term, because increasingly many fields have started treating the animal as the center of talks about relation, about the existence, about moral values, philosophy, etc. And human relations have seen a lot of changes in the way they exist and they are described. Like, for example, Donna Haraway spoke about the importance of talking about pets as more companion species. And she was a term person who used the term and popularized the term. And you now have a change from pet to companion, keeper or owner to guardian. And because of this, there was an importance on having more equitable relations between animal and human. And also the fact that perhaps we should recognize that what we need from the animal is as much important for ourselves as for the animal. You know, there's no more the old role of guardianship or being owner of the living. And instead, there's an emphasis on more equitable relationships between human and animal. The other question is that of domestication. There's an increasing amount of work that looked at old notions of domestication and turned it on its head and started to theorize that perhaps animals were domesticated not because humans wanted them, but because humans didn't know what to do with them. There are these series of animals which seem to gravitate towards human settlements and be more comfortable in the borderlands between nature and human. And because humans didn't know what to do with these kind of species exactly, they become domesticated. So there's the whole notion of commensal species that live close to human beings being domesticated. And this stood on its head, old notions of domesticated as human mastery, and instead turned into a much more equitable sense that animals are seen as agents rather than just being subjects. And that again returned to our ideas. Although these new ideas are reflected in animal studies work and work in human animal relations, animal theorists these days say that still the emphasis tends to be on outcome, you know. What is the meaning of this relation to us humans? How do humans benefit from it? Rather than looking at how do these relationships actually work between humans and animals. If you want to look at how boundaries are placed or how they work, how does this really happen in process? Instead, we are still interested in looking at what's the outcome of these relationships. What does it really mean to human beings? Animals and they can't talk. And in the middle of all these discussions, we also noted that although some species are at the forefront of these discussions, some species are not. Nobody really is talking about whether snakes feel pain. There are a lot of questions about whether dogs have emotions and cats have or horses have and some other wild species have. But we are not really talking about our species. Nepocomium species are less equal than others, and we are still determining which comes to the foreground, which goes to the background. And building upon that, among some species which are more equal than others, the picture really shows, again a series of images, popular animal relationships that are presented in the media, which stand up very much in our head. Ticks have now up as companion animals, by the way. You know, and a lot of people related to the publicity of the popularity of this particular movie. And there's a lot of work now which looks at ticks as companion animals. There's also been a lot of work on parrots as companion animals. There are certain wild animals that have also become popular for the sense of a relationship with human beings, feeling the dolphin. And of course, Bond film sets that very great scene on the lion and human being and what relationship with the wild animal means. There was a jackal on the moon, much, much earlier about wolves and human beings and what part they played. But very few, I think, will match the last picture. Very classic picture of Jane Goodall reaching out to the chimpanzee. And Jane Goodall and the collaborators, her contemporaries, Dan Fossey and Guru Tegalasika, who worked a lot on Bhutan, really set the scene for a huge change in what you think about animals. And Primus has been at the center of this debate for a very, very long time now. Primus has been at the center of debates on human animal relations for a very long time for a number of reasons. One is, of course, because we're biologically related to say later events. Two is, of course, the behavioral similarities, the social similarities that we tend to see between us. And this is Louis Leakey in 1960, who responded to Jane Goodall's first discovery of the fact that chimps use tubes. So she had observed a chimp taking a stick, putting it into a termite hole, pulling it out, and then licking the termite off it, and her first use of a tube. And when she reported that to Leakey, it was 1960, Leakey, who had encouraged and sent her out of the field, Louis Leakey, that he was an anthropologist, and who actually sent her all three of the great women thinkers in primatology. He was also responsible for encouraging Diane Fossey to go out and Kalarika's quote and study Parampash. Anyway, that's a different story. Leakey, so when he heard Jane speak about tool use, said this very classic statement, now we must redefine tool, redefine man, for a chimpanzee as human. And that I think is a classic statement because it sort of encapsulates the overgoing arguments about why we have such difficulty accepting primates or any other species as equal to humans. And we have certain characteristics that we think are uniquely human, and the other species don't have it, they are not human or they don't reach up to it. And this is challenging that particular statement. But I'm getting ahead of my story. So if you treat primates as a case study of trying to understand through primates as to how people have viewed animals, it's a very, very interesting story there. So in the 70s and the 80s, I'm treating this particular period because this is just after the time when the great ape studies began, and Jane Goodall started studying chimpanzees, Dan Fossey started studying gorillas, and Dorothy started studying orangutans. And there was more information about primates coming from the wild, about their social behavior, about their cognitive pathology, about their organization, etc. And by this time, they have also started debates on, based on the new information that was available about primates now, they started debates about, are we treating primates well? Because tied to all this is a larger background story about how we use animals, primates, a great deal in experiments, biomedical experiments, for example. Primates are used a great deal. And stories, I mean, debates about human rights, they're going on the background for a very, very long time now. And people who have fought animal rights were using statements about sentience, about consciousness, and about how we should be treating these animals with respect and not be putting them through this entire tree. So there is background story of animal rights that's in the background. And The arguments that were used to bolster Nirmala's rights ranged from we are keepers of guardians and animals, therefore we should treat them better. Two, they are equal to us, you know. So if you wouldn't treat a human being the same way, why are you treating animals the same way? And somewhere in the middle, tries to pose the question of, are animals equal to humans, or do we just look down upon them and treat them better now? And these three arguments that have told you, language and what morality is, are the three points on which people are trying to argue about the state of a personhood that should be given to primates. So initially, when primates are shown to have great social organization, deep bonding between primate species, between mother and infant, certain that we share, you would have social scientists stand up and say, no, no, only humans have told you, we are the most superior species of all. Any species that cannot use humans cannot be considered on the same level with us. And that, of course, was broken down when Jane Goodall and other people's work, Nita Pensit, they use tools as much as we do, they have culture as much as we do. Then came the second row of arguments, the debate about language. Language is what separates us from other species. We are the highest up, maybe have language, and other species don't have. And then there were these language experiments with chimps, and well, mainly chimps that were done. Apes that were, chimps that taught American Sign Language, and they communicated extremely well. This was even, they could teach language also. And there were also studies on other species also, dolphins, for example, which showed great language and communicative skills. Language failed. The current debate lies on the ground of morality, that only we have moral values, only humans have moral values, and animals don't have. Primates certainly don't, and hence they will always be on a plane lower than humans. There have, of course, been resorts to this. Most famously, Franz Dewar, in his book Primates and Philosophers, and also Marc Dekoff, who talks about consciousness and morality values, and tries to start with this argument saying that primates have as many morals as we have. There are certain points in which they also work, which is against primate sociality and human sociality, and therefore that argument does not really hold well. More recently, from 2012, there's a huge argument when Witten had published an extremely interesting article which documented culture in different populations of chimpanzees. And there were other scientists and social biologists who were not willing to accept the argument yet. So that debate goes on. But this is merely an example to show you what are the various points on which boundaries between humans and animals have been drawn and have been polished throughout the years. Because once these boundaries fall, then what comes to the question is, how do we really treat animals? Do we treat them as we do, or is there other ways we should be treating them? Richard Dawkins has a much more pragmatic answer to the whole boundary question. So in Long Electron, other issues that he wrote in 2009, he retorts, our ethics and our politics assume, largely without question or serious discussion, that the division between human and animal is absolute. But such essentialism is deeply unrevolutionary. If there were a heaven in which all the animals who ever lived could frolic, we would find an interbreeding continuum between every species and every other. So that is a very hard-nosed biologist point of view, but also it seems to see no boundaries what this whole question about with just all the same. That was Richard Dawkins in 2009. In a sense, I think the final word on it must come from Simboskar, who once again beautifully condensed form into the poem for the monkey says, in fables, lonely, not sure what to do, he fills up mirrors with indiscreet self-mockery, a lesson for us too, the poor relation who knows all about us, though we don't greet each other when we meet. That, I think, is really reality. So to come to the next section, I've so far talked about how the Western culture has viewed it and what ongoing debates about boundaries between human and animal and how the strength has changed and what the present consensus. But But this is a very Western model of viewpoint. It's not applicable globally. And I'd like to show a little bit from other cultures, more specifically I talk about India, particularly what are our relationships with animals. But before that, a brief view. Like I said, there are other cultures where the boundaries are not so much of a problem. They are much more porous. As you can see, the first image is that of animals is the jack of headed god, Egyptian culture. And the second is the Buddhist deity, the snake god, that's half human and half snake. And the third is, of course, the Yakshagana, or the half human, half monkey, which is part of an Indian culture. And from all these images, which are considered all cultures, you will note that there is not so much discomfort with the whole human animal divide. These are very porous boundaries and it's acceptable completely. And in fact, the Egyptians believed that animals spoke to the gods, and that was the meaning of communicating with the gods. To pull out another strand from the story, I'd like to go to India and to species that I work with. This is the reef of macaque. People in Delhi must be, of course, very much familiar with this particular species. It's biologically speaking extremely interesting species. Very adaptable, it has a geographic range, it's going like the humans, found across Southeast Asia. So it's a very fascinating surrounding species. It can be quite something to meet them. It's a highly adaptable one. It's found both in urban areas as well as rural populations. It's not a very wild animal, it's found all across. And in India, of course, it's great prominence in some years now. It's been branded as the simian terrorist, and this is how it's been referred to. Okay, so why is that so? The classical problem seems to be what is called conflict. Why we have conflict? This was not only restricted to the race of macaque. We do have conflict with many, many wildlife species. But I take the case of the race of macaque simply because there are many aspects to it which I find fascinating. So what are the main aspects for the race of human conflict? It happens in two kinds of areas. Unlike other wildlife species that I've had, it happens in a form of crop raiding, which is in rural India. And in India, this will largely affect the states of Madhya Pradesh and Uttarakhand, which again, where horticulture and agriculture is the mainstay of the economy. And farmers estimate that close to 100 crore and 75 crore are lost due to depredation by the rhesus macaque. And it's been a very, very sore point for the farmers in these two states. In fact, it came to a situation where you would remember that the rhesus was declared as a vermin. There were licenses was given on the shoe to rhesus macaque, and they gave this a withdrawal. But yeah, that's an example of conditions brought to. It's also an awareness because it's found in cities, and cities in North India and sometimes in South also. It does a great deal of damage to kittens, property raising. There were also cases of injury and even death to humans. So overall, it's been a problem. But I would like to focus on the first part of it instead of crop raiding and the wild animal becomes a pest. So I merely stated this case because it was background information. My colleagues and I looked at this particular crop raiding problem and we were interested in seeing the issues of how much crop depredation does the research really cause. You know, it tends to be in matters of crop raiding and conflict, studies have shown how bigger diurnal species tend to occupy the attention of people. And that actually people may experience more crop damage through pathogens or other smaller vermin, but this is not really registered. It's only the bigger species that tend to come into your foreground of your mind. And that's the problem with conflict studies, actually measuring how much damage does a particular species cause. And it's useful to know. Because people, in fact, in a study in Southeast Asia, it was seen that although farmers blamed macaques as being the main crop loss creature, crop depredator, it was actually rats that had caused the problem. So people went out to study, actually measured crop loss between the two species, and then went back to the farmers to explain this. And that brought the change. So this is methodology in conflict studies. And one of the things my colleagues and I were trying to see is if the rhesus macaque really are is crop depredator, because there are other crop depredators. The wild, for example, there are birds and many other species. So one thing we are trying to see is what do people perceive and what is reality? Perception is the first problem. So we did what is called a perception study. We interviewed people across it and asked them to estimate that is missing is pieces of cloth. The second master said, look, you get sure this and get back and check. But I don't go to that one study. What interested me was this particular table. This is one part of the data. I'm not going to go and get the paper. If you could see, we had asked them how or what they think about the research. And these are not options that we gave, these options that we came up with. And most of them, if you see, only saw it as a presentation of cost. And this is also another aspect of research conflict in India, as in many parts of Southeast Asia. All the people looked up that it is a test and it caused a great deal of damage. They are inhibited to do any amount of damage to the species itself. This religious, of course, a big part of it. But yeah, that exists. What interested me here was most of the people saw it as a representation of God. Smaller majority saw it as an agricultural test. Some people thought both, so they would say, yes, it is this, is that also, and it helps both and then it's you. But what is even more fascinating is very few people actually saw it as a part of nature, and only one person thought it was a wild animal. I found that really fascinating. There was only one person of all the many people that you interviewed who thought the rhesus is a wild animal. Everybody else thought, there are some people who said, it's a fascinated, just like I am. And many of people said, it's health, it's God, and that. But very few people actually saw it as a wild animal. And that brings us to the question of the concept of a species. When you think about an animal, what do you really think about it as? And this is not a problem that is only relevant to the research, it does occur for some of the few species. And work on these animals has brought the use of something called liminal species. These are species that tend to occupy what are called borderlands, or that separation that we draw between nature and human, and they stay somewhere in those borderlands. Walter Nemel, animal geographer, came up with a term which called as borderland community. These represent those species which cannot be categorized. And it raises several questions of categorization and the human fashion of categorization. Everything has to be classified for us. You know, everything has fall very neatly into certain blocks. And if not within those classes, we don't know what to, how to deal with it. So biologically, the rhesus macaque is classified as a weed macaque, a leaf concern species. Let me talk more about these terms. A weed macaque was a term used by a biologist, a primatologist, somewhere in 87, to classify certain monkey species that tended to live in close contact with human citizens, rather than belonging to the forest, as they should. Richards, who did the study, found that some monkey species tended to gravitate towards human settlements and live in close contact with human settlements. So she identified a list of monkey species which called on the list. The rhesus were stock moose, the border macaque of South India, the toque macaque of Sri Lanka, the long-tailed macaque of Southeast Asia. All these monkey species tended to call to human settlements and settle near them, live in close association. They were not domesticated in any sense. They just lived in association. And she called them bee macaque because she said, like bees, they proliferate in these spaces near human communities. That's why they were called the weed macaque. So that's a very, very early description for the rhesus macaque. The leaf concern is the IUPAC classification for the rhesus macaque because it talks about the fact that we don't need to concern ourselves with its conservation. There are some species which seem to be numerous. It's a common, it's a huge, red or hot tree. And therefore the IUPAC enters there. The IUPAC enters the various conservation unions, that's a threat list which classifies animals in priority of conservation. And that lot, the rhesus is somewhere way down at the bottom. So, then you have Donaldson and Kimnicka who called species like the rhesus liminal species. You have Walsh and Emel calling species like the rhesus as borderland species. You know where to call them, you know it's found in the wild or you know it's found in the domesticated. Basically, reality is that we are sharing space with humans. And we are not sharing it in a sense that we do domesticated animals, where we have an ownership. Instead, we are sharing the species that we don't own, we are not companions with, and we really don't know what to do with them. And that's an issue of where do you put this particular species come? And that point also is the question of, is there the boundary between this particular species and me? Where do I put it? In physical scale, there is no boundary really here. In our head, what do you think about it? So those were different strands that I had, and we'll try now and take these different strands and see how much sense we can make out of it. So in the earlier strands we talked about how notions about the animal and human life changed, and where we have moved from an animal rights side to a more a companion viewpoint. And we saw in India how, as in many other cultures, how perhaps boundaries are not so tight and much more porous. And therefore questions that bioscientific hybrids raise would perhaps not be so much of a problem, because we always seem to be, you know, comfortable with the notion of a half animal, half human hybrid creature. So these are several areas or approaches that try to make sense of what a boundary between human animals, what do animals mean to humans. And there have been a few approaches which are particularly useful for bringing more clarity to this. And in this, I like to talk about ethnoprimatology, animal geography, and what is called ANT, or actor theory network. Ethnoprimatology arises from primatology, that's the dedicated science studying primates. But from that comes a much more new approach called ethnoprimatology, which basically just documents interfaces between humans and animals. It is not done with a particular conservationist viewpoint, it's not done with a particular biologist viewpoint either. It merely documents the many networks that we have between humans and animals. So that's one. The second is animal geography. Animal geography, of course, existed a very long time ago, in the several avatars. And the latest talks about physical space and how this forms a context or a background to discussions of human animal rights. And this is, of course, something that I talked about earlier, that of borderland communities, the actual physical space that exists between human and animal. And animal geography looks at animals and interactions between them from that point of view. Actor theory network is approach in polar studies that looks at networks between humans and non-humans. So it doesn't limit itself only to human social relations as being the focus of attention. Instead, it tries to draw more attention to the multiple networks that exist between humans and other parts of the ecosystem. Okay? For example, Bruno Latour talked about the pasteurization of France, and he talked about pasteurization, how it served a very important way to look at how humans connect to bacteria, to milk, to processes, to political processes, and a whole bunch of other stuff. And what these three approaches do is actually throw the human, at least from the pedestal down, set the ground for a more equitable network of relationships between organisms, human beings being one of them, and also make animals as much agents of change more than being subjects. So it's a testimony to that. And that's what these three approaches try to do in different ways. And I'd like to make particular mention of two books here which use these approaches to talk about relations between humans and animals. Loretta Cormier, Kinship of Monkeys, and a beautifully ethical approach about relationships between the virgin tribe in Amazonia and monkeys. So the women there, if you can see the picture, actually have found a monkey on the head and a child. And women there actually suckle monkeys just like they do children. But these same monkeys can also be eaten by a virgin. And that's what interested Cormier to go and study the tribe. And she found that for them, all species existed within a network of connection. Therefore, consuming anything as food is actually cannibalism. They did not actually see eating the monkey, which they had said as a child, a cannibalism, because even eating any food is cannibalistic. Everything was connected in equal network, and that's how the brothers lived. The study goes on to look at how this can people to look at other aspects of Pranathandish Prabhu gets into that. So that's also a very, very beautiful approach by Karma. The other book of Pranath says it is, which is again the Bible of ethnopanthropism, which documented again several relationships of this sort that can occur between humans and animals and how they can range from cooperation on one hand to conflict on the other. And some of the case studies in that, for example, talk about the Siktir Makat in Thailand, which is used to pick coconuts. And this is a study by Ponsel. And the Siktir Makat in Thailand is actually used to pick coconuts, used as a labor force. But the interesting part is that people actually go to the forest, take macaques from there, the little infants, bring them back, and grow them like offspring within the house, which are then taken out to pick coconuts and, you know, be made use of. The Western viewpoint on this talked about how the animal was used as labor. The people themselves were involved in this. Did not see much difference between the Siktir Makat and their own offspring. Both were used equally. Sons are there to vote and work and bring money to the house. Similarly, Siktir Makat also does the same thing, and that's about the So this book talks about how difference in perspectives is what really makes you think about relations. And what really brings the difference between how we look at relations and how we look at animals. Perspectives are all. And to build on a perspective angle, that is, of course, I come to the second point first, that of commensalism and domestication, which I talked about earlier. And Brockwell and O'Connor talked about how domestication happens because humans do not know what to do with the animals that were living around them. You know, they simply know what to do, and therefore they became domesticated or companions of pets. Combined with the earlier three approaches that you have seen, you can see how these approaches generally tend to make animals as agents rather than being subjects, and how it stands on the head of old notion of human ordering the world around them. It doesn't really take the same role in these approaches at least. And to add to that perspective, that of Ingold. Ingold, who looked at differences between pastoral societies and nomadic gatherers, and who thinks that Ingold, among others, sees that the difference in Western heritage of the way you look at animals actually comes from when nomadic gatherers turned into pastoral societies. When nomadic gatherers turned into pastoralism, the old notion of being one of the animals, making use of them, and also living with them became turned into conquering mentality because they were out to agriculture and therefore you subdue the nature. And this translated to a much more ownership attitude to nature. And it was seen that dramatic difference occurs at that point. Nomadic animals turned to pastoralism. And Ingold has written a great deal about human relations and how they view animals. And I found what he had to say about the power of narrative particularly interesting. So Ingold says, just as humans have a history of their relations with animals, so also animals have a history of their relations with humans. The only difference is that they express ourselves, we describe, we characterize animals who have the voice to lose in particular. And which is why only human voices are heard. Animals and agents and themselves are simply not heard. It's not that they don't act or they don't have any power, it's just that we don't hear them. And I'll end, predictably enough, with some more Freudian. Freudian talks about perspective and what the power is. So she speaks about how the window has a wonderful view of a lake, but the view itself doesn't view itself. It exists in this world, colorless, shapeless, soundless, odorless, and painless. Thank you very much.